porn. For generations, a teenage army of nudge-nudge, wank-wank Brits have been secretly cracking one out to steamy scenes and dodgy plots. And the worst that could happen is it could make you go blind. But now...
Online pornography is corroding child.
It's turning our kids into psychopaths. I'm Martin Daubney. I was the editor of Loaded magazine, but now I'm a dad. I'm getting involved in the first ever scientific study to see what porn actually does to our brains. Because I want to know, is all this fuss about online porn just reactionary, conservative, middle-aged moaning?
We have never brought up a generation of boys with access to hardcore pornography.
I think it's terrifying, the potential scale of this.
It makes perfect sense that they would be vulnerable.
Or is it true?
Every bit of spare time I have in the day is watching porn.
Is internet porn really destroying our kids' brains?
We're seeing people 15 and 16 years old who are struggling with porn addiction.
Hello, my name is Martin, and I'm a wanker, as I'm sure are many of you. But I like to think of myself as something of a wanking connoisseur, because I grew up in the golden age of porn. These were the years when porn left the seedy back streets of Soho and found itself on the top shelves of W.H. Smith's. Shrink-wrapped Bibles of pubes and boobs that schoolboys could trade like football stickers in the playground. Gone was Victorian prudish guilt. For the first time, porn was fun. My own career in porn started by accident. My dad was a miner and a bit of a lad. One Christmas when I was 10, I went looking for my presents.
I was getting Subutio that year, I remember it with total clarity. Right, I went under the bed and my innocence was forever damaged by a biscuit tin I found. It contained some porn mags, thick with coal dust. So I think that means they weren't mums.
Well, it could have been. Anyway, those things there were private. You should never add your nose into them anyway.
In actual fact, I think finding those magazines was a bit of a moment.
Was it?
Yeah, because...
Yeah. You realise that's what you was going to grow into. You was going to be one.
What?
A wanker.
Well, I think that's what came out of it. Everyone was at it.
But men have done it for generations, Martin. Mm.
After my dalliance with Dad's biscuit tin, my access to porn pretty much dried up. No surprise, then, that my first act of manual relief was to a biology textbook from the school library at the tender age of 13. But in 1984, my world changed forever when we got our first VHS recorder. Soon, I was wearing out the tape, rerunning Beatrice Dahl's sultry, nay, seminal performance in Betty Blue. Or hovering over my portable TV, watching Red Triangle Films on Channel 4.
The film carries this symbol as a warning that it contains sexual imagery that you may find offensive.
By 16, I was bored of wanking, so started a band with my mate Nige. Soon, we discovered it was easier to get hold of real girls than it was porn. I grew up, I became a journalist, and by 2003, I was editor of Loaded. With its diet of girls, booze, and celebrities, we were living the dream. Some called Loaded porn, but hey, it was the noughties. Andrew and Joel, like all my mates at Loaded, had grown up with the same cheeky top shelf glosses.
It's all sort of shot through the Vaseline lens. Everything's natural. The phallic grip on the tap.
Is that a gold bath?
Yeah, the gold bath.
It was kind of cool to say you liked porn, even if you didn't actually use it.
Yeah.
It was almost like it became more acceptable for it to be a bit ruder and have more girls in it. And it's almost like I think we were told that that's what sold.
But at the time, it never occurred to us that this was porn. But if you showed that to a feminist, they'd go, well, of course that's porn. There are two girls with their tongues down each other's throats. We were being criticised for having high nipple counts by the outside world. Our readers were telling us they wanted more nipples. So we just did 100 pairs of boobs. Do you remember? Just focus on the boobs without actually having any
hands. Well, it was just it was sort of a little bit of a tongue-in-cheek.
It was, yeah. We were doing it as, here is just page after page after page.
If that's what you want.
Yeah, that's what you want. You know, bang, here's the howitzer. And we did it. And we thought that was really clever and funny. Of course, our critics went, you're not even having the girls' heads anymore. It's just about their breasts. And we were like, oh, shit, yeah. But it wasn't the critics that put an end to all our nipple-counting fun. It was the rise and rise of the internet. By 2008, download speeds had gone from an achingly slow 40 kilobytes a second to a blinding 3.6 megabytes per second. The age of innocence was over. Then I became a dad. I left loaded and embarked on what I called a porn vacation. My lad Sonny is now 4, and he is my beautiful little boy.
Oh, he fell over.
But according to the Children's Commissioner, kids may be exposed to online pornography by the age of 10. So what delights has Sonny got in store? There's only one way to find out. I type 4 letters into Google. Here we go then. It's been a while, so how much has porn changed? The first thing I see is 2 gaping orifices. It looks like some sort of sea creature. It's actually an Asian girl's posterior towards the camera, and it's called Asian Slut Double Dipped. It's literally within 2 seconds of logging on. It's bang, straight in there. 2 erect dicks, straight in the mouth. He's got hold of her hair, he's twisting her head back, he's ramming it. Granny porn, so this is 10 seconds into our journey. Oh, God. There's a granny, it looks like, you know, one of those grannies that looks like an old bloke. Yeah, oh, God. She looks like Anne Widdecombe. She's got a great big penis in her mouth. Yeah, she's the sort of granny you'd expect to see making jam, not making porn. Of course, there was hardcore stuff around in my day, but you had to make a proper effort to find it, and it was bloody expensive. Now, you just click and it's all there, for free. And if I can access it this easily, then surely anyone can. So is this what kids are streaming on their smartphones and passing around the playground like top trumps? To find out, I'm going to have to talk to the kids themselves. So I'm visiting York High School, where a group of 13 to 15 year olds have been asked to compile an A to Z of words they know about sex from the internet.
Rectum, vagina, virginity.
It's like a foreign language. Until today, I thought bukkake was a type of motorbike. So how do they know all this stuff?
It pops up at any time, like we on Facebook or advertisements. You don't have any control over it, it just pops up.
Yeah, it's like just going on Facebook and then you're just like scrolling down and it's just there.
It's like because someone in your friends, if they've commented on it or liked it, it comes up on your homepage.
That Facebook stuff, Sonny's been like coming on the last couple of like months, hasn't it?
Yeah.
From pigs to dogs to fish.
To horse.
That's just...
You wouldn't go out for a date with a horse, would you?
It's one where this woman was rubbing honey on her vagina and then a pig, like, licked it. So like, she was intending for the pig to react to the honey on her, so...
It's just disgusting. Ongoing.
I mean, do you have parental control at home?
No,
on your internet,
mate.
People that watch it are going to find a way to watch it if, like, parents did do that anyway, wouldn't they?
I hear loads of people going on about it, but yeah, I just tend not to, and I notice I just don't talk to people who do because I find it quite dirty and disturbing.
So British teenagers are just consuming porn wholesale?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Whether they want to or not, these children are watching explicit material online, some of which is even illegal. And judging by their advanced vocabulary, they've been at it for some time. I decided to dig a little deeper into this rolling buffet of online depravity. I like to think I'm unshockable, but within a few clicks, things got really dark. God, there's a woman lying in a public park. There's a guy lying down with a gimp mask on. His fist is inside her. A man is standing above her. You can't see his head. He's pissing all over her face and into her mouth. The next one I've just come straight across. Looks like child porn. Her hair's done in pigtails. She's surrounded by cuddly toys. She's got like a nappy on. He's pulled the nappy off. She's woken up. She's smiling. He's now fisting her. This is like kind of staged incest, really. It's designed to look like a dad shagging a daughter, I think. I don't remember being exposed to anything like this ever in my life. It's just gross. Something's changed here, and it's lost its sense of humour, and it's become something altogether more macabre. Where's the enjoyment gone? Where's the innocence gone? Now we're just seeing something that's just all about a world of male domination and female humiliation. What's really frightening is that these hideous videos could be watched by any child because they're so easy to stumble across. But is watching this kind of material actually damaging teenagers' lives? We wanted to test this question scientifically, so we collaborated on a world-first study that would look at the brain on porn. This is a programme all about porn. Not long ago, that would have been a cause of celebration for me. Now, it's not so funny. I've been wading through all the articles that have been written about the effects of online porn on our kids. There's a lot of hysteria, but very little fact. On the one hand, we have people's damaged by hardcore porn. Lots of angry politicians jumping on the bandwagon, as you'd expect. Pornography leads children to have sex. Another angry MP, children exposed to too much pornography on the internet. And then over here we have neuroscience research fails to support claims that excessive pornography consumption causes brain damage. We don't seem to have any kind of conclusions other than some people think it's hideously wrong, other people think it's okay and it's our freedom of choice to consume it. But there's no tangible proof that it's doing anything wrong other than lots and lots of opinions. So we commissioned our own survey from the University of East London into teenage porn habits. The results are genuinely shocking. In the 16 to 19 age group, 10% of girls and 13% of the boys said that the sexual imagery they are watching is becoming more and more extreme. Incredibly, one-fifth of the boys say they are dependent on porn as a stimulant for real sex. One man who knows all about these problems is John Grant. A US-based clinician and world-renowned expert in addiction, he's seeing more and more young men with porn-related problems, including erectile dysfunction.
15 years ago, I would say my average patient was probably 40, 50 years old. Now, university students, so 18, 19, 20, is very routine. You can get on the internet anywhere, everywhere, at the age of whatever, 12, as soon as you hit puberty, and start looking at pornography.
Professor Grant worries that online porn is affecting young people's brains.
We know that all sorts of behaviors that we do activate our brain. I mean, we run, we expect people to get a runner's high, right? Which is an endorphin release. And so it shouldn't be really a surprise that if I look at porn all day, and my grandma could tell you, there's something wrong with you.
So what sort of lad spends all day watching porn? A socially awkward geek who lives in a basement? And anyway, why would they want to talk to me? Imagine my surprise then when I met Callum. He's 19, an apprentice, and a good-looking boy. And he's volunteered to talk on camera about his problem because he wants to speak out about the effects of porn on young people.
At first, obviously, I didn't know the limits and the bounds of what is extreme until I speak to my friends and I'd find out how much they view of porn, and it just didn't compare. Like, every bit of spare time I have in the day is watching porn. I felt that that is extreme.
How many times a day?
15 or 16 times.
In total?
Yeah. I think the most is about 28 in times a day, but and that was pushing it. That's when it starts to throb. You get that little climax, and then straight after that, it's painful for about 10 or 20 minutes. It's like getting kicked in the bollocks. But then, I have no choice, you have to do it. As soon as that urge just clicks, that's it. That's why I'm coming for help. Because I want to be able to control it. Because if I don't do it, it may help me to think that, like, sex is a lot more pleasurable. That's what I was hoping, really.
You've been very open and brave. You know, I'm addicted to porn. How do you think people are going to react to that?
Obviously, it'll be a bit alien to some people, and but then others may understand it because they may be facing the same problem. They just come public with it. Because some people see it as a topic that shouldn't be talked about.
Callum feels like he's addicted. And if that's true, then we really do need to talk about this.
Common sense and my own experience tells me that wanking 16 times a day just cannot be healthy. Trouble is, science doesn't do common sense. Science needs data.
And until that data is put forward as hard fact, medicine will not recognise porn addiction as a condition. So we look for someone really smart who could collate scientific data for us. Which is where Dr. Valerie Voon, a top neuroscientist at Cambridge University, enters the frame. Valerie is a global authority on addiction and what it does to addicts' brains. In recent years, functional MRI scanners have allowed scientists to peer inside the brains of those addicted to substances like alcohol, nicotine or cocaine to see how they differ from the rest of us. The focus is on a network of interconnected areas across the brain, the so-called reward network. Here, pleasure is processed and evaluated. At the heart of the network is the ventral striatum, the reward center. This is where our sense of pleasure is first produced. Food, sex, drugs, it's all registered as delicious, as something we want more of. When shown the focus of their addiction, an alcoholic's reward center will show an exaggerated response. Their brains crave the drink now, while the rest of us can wait till later. No one has ever scanned the brains of porn users who feel like they are addicted. Even Valerie took some convincing.
I wasn't sure what to expect when I first started this study, to be perfectly frank. And in part because we just know so little about it. I was quite skeptical and I was a bit ambivalent about the study.
After a nationwide search, we found 20 men aged 19 to 34 whose lives were so controlled by porn they were willing to take part in our study.
Comfortable.
They didn't want to be identified, but they were prepared to be scanned by Dr. Voon. They'd be compared with a control group of healthy male volunteers.
We're running a series of tests using functional MRI to look at brain activity. We're asking whether or not there might be differences in terms of brain activity in specific regions.
Are you relaxed?
Good to go.
Okay, we're going to start. We're just having a quick scroll through his brain, making sure that everything's where it should be. Like you would do with a boiled egg, just take the top off.
The subjects of the study were shown images of explicit porn to see if their reward centres would respond in the same way as drug addicts. If they did, it would suggest that porn might indeed be addictive for them. Although I wasn't part of the study, I had volunteered to be scanned for the programme. And by this point, I was absolutely crapping myself. After all, I'd spent 15 years of my career micro-analysing naked women. Would I be exposed as a porn fiend?
One last scan.
When the data was analysed, the results were astounding. While the ordinary people were clearly excited by porn, as you'd expect, the compulsive users' brains were twice as active in their ventral striatum, just like addicts responding to drugs or alcohol.
In people who are dependent on nicotine, alcohol or cocaine, when they're exposed to cues, they end up having an increase in activity. So what we see here is in response to an explicit video.
Yes.
And we see there's a very clear increase in activity in the reward center.
And there was more. The reward networks of the compulsive porn users were lighting up like Christmas trees. Areas involved in anticipating the porn, physically responding to the porn, and prioritizing the porn were all hyperactivated. It's as if these guys' entire reward network is being hijacked by pornography.
Absolutely great. Brilliant.
And to my immense relief, mine wasn't. Like the healthy volunteers, my response to the porn was barely visible, whereas the porn users' brains were going ballistic.
That's a really profound difference compared to, you know, these guys whose brains are firing up like fireworks. So that's a very, very profound effect that porn's having on them.
Yeah, it is a very profound effect.
And the reaction that the porn user's having to porn there, they can't control that, can they? They can't affect the outcome.
No, they can't.
If people are saying that porn is addictive, and it's like, well, where's the proof? If the proof is the same parts of the brain are firing in the same way, that seems pretty compelling.
Yeah, compulsive pornography users do have parallels with substance use disorders, and that's on several levels. This is easily one of the first studies of its kind. But what I would emphasize is that a lot more work needs to be done.
Dr. Voon's results will form part of a wider study intended for publication in a peer-reviewed journal. But already, the results are painting a pretty scary picture.
It might be early days, but this research seems to show that porn can be addictive. If that's the case, and we allow our children free access to online porn, that's like leaving heroin lying around the house.
So what does this mean for young men in the real world like Callum? If porn has the potential to be like a drug, how does it affect his life? And can he even get a girlfriend?
So what about real girls? Like you have a lot of sex with real girls, don't you?
Yeah.
So what kind of sex do you have with these real girls?
Depends what they have. Like if they have a really nice ass, it has to be anal. Or if they have really nice boobs, it has to be like missionary where I can see them and play with them. Just all depends on what they've got to offer. It's not as good as masturbating. It's not as good because they're not as good as the porn. Obviously the porn girls have done it a lot more and a lot more confident. Real girls don't have confidence. But I just feel annoyed because I'm not getting the pleasure I should be from real girls.
For Callum, porn is literally better than sex. And he's probably not alone. In our survey of 16 to 19 year olds, 23% of boys said they tried to stop watching porn but couldn't. That's almost one in four lads who have trouble controlling their porn habit. And as if that wasn't enough, there's something that makes everything I've found so far even more disturbing. The special nature of the teenage brain that makes it uniquely vulnerable to addiction. I've seen that porn might be addictive, but what does that actually mean? If more and more kids are watching porn, how is it affecting their developing brains?
I remember being a teenager. I had an amazing ability to learn new things fast, an insatiable thirst for new experiences, and I really liked taking risks.
This kind of behaviour is no accident. It's because of the incredible way that teenage brain is developing.
The brain of a 19-year-old is all about gimme, gimme, gimme. I want it. I find it pleasurable. This is why 19-year-olds drive fast. They experiment with sex. They experiment with drugs. I mean, this is the time, that sort of 14 to 25-year-old range.
The brain's reward center, the primal pleasure zone, is fully developed by the time we're teenagers. But the part of the brain that regulates teenage urges, the prefrontal cortex, doesn't fully develop until our mid-20s. Until then, we're all accelerator and no brakes.
What we're hoping during that time for a lot of young adults is that their prefrontal cortex is gradually kicking in and asking them, should you want this? What are the repercussions of this choice? What are the long-term consequences of this behavior? But until, or if that doesn't kick in for some people as robustly as it should, they're all about drive state. They're all about wanting.
And this impulsiveness, this lack of a prefrontal cortex that can say no, makes some teenagers particularly vulnerable to addiction. One recent study found that the more impulsive and risk-taking a teenager was, the more likely they were to drink heavily in the future. The study was carried out by Professor Matt Field.
We gave them some tests of risk-taking and also some tests which measured their ability to control or inhibit a behaviour. Now, what we found was that the kids who were very bad at inhibiting themselves and the kids who took a lot of risks on the computer tests we gave them, those kids were drinking more alcohol later on.
So is the teenage brain in that sense kind of super sensitive to addiction?
Yes, that seems to be the case. If addiction to online porn is a recognised problem, then it does make perfect sense that adolescents would be more vulnerable to it. The way that their brains are set up, they're particularly vulnerable to addiction to drugs and alcohol and to gambling and other kind of behavioural addictions. That, combined with the fact they're particularly sensitive to sexual stimuli because of the hormonal changes that are going on, yes, it makes perfect sense that they would be vulnerable.
All the science I've heard so far must apply to Callum, the 19-year-old lad I've been getting to know. Yet he seems so mature and in control. He offered to take me on a tour of where he went on a typical night out. So I could get to know him better, it was just the two of us, with me operating the camera.
I admire your guts to face up to what you're going through. But underneath all of that, you actually seem like quite a nice, ordinary guy.
I try.
Is that what you're hoping? That if you just take the porn out of your life, yeah, you're a normal guy and you want to do normal things?
Mm. Yeah, that would be nice. Because obviously there's going to be a time where I want to settle down at some point.
You want wife and kids?
Yeah.
Why do you think you've got this relationship with porn?
Don't know. I really don't know. I just think that's just something that my brain must have picked up when I was younger and just got into it, and it's got worse and worse and worse as I've got older. I just want to get it out of my life because it is causing a big problem. I can't find a way to stop. I've tried getting rid of my smartphone, but like getting rid of easy ways to get onto porn, but then I just get an urge and I'll go into the toilet and I'll visualise it instead.
Does that piss you off?
Yeah, of course. You just get times where you sit there and think to yourself, why have I just done what I've done? Why? You get high and then you just get down straight afterwards.
And how do you get over that low?
Do it again.
So you're always chasing the low away with the next high.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that sounds like a drug addiction to
me. Yeah, it is, virtually. Because I can't stop it.
We've been talking for about half an hour when suddenly I get a glimpse of the reality of Callum's compulsion. We drive past a girl in hot pants and it triggers something.
What was it about her that sent you off?
Nice, tight little shorts that show off everything that she's got.
Right, so we've pulled into a pub. Mm-hmm. Where are you off to?
Just going to go to the toilet, with me.
Yeah. I'll just wait here, mate.
Yeah, that's fine.
He goes. He's going in for a wank. Right, mate? Better?
Yeah.
So, be honest, crack one out?
Yeah. So annoying afterwards.
How do you feel now?
Pissed off.
Why?
Because it's just like, for that split second, I just feel like it's the best thing to do, and then as soon as I've finished, it's like, why the fuck did I just do that?
So how are you feeling?
Not too good.
This is the low?
Yeah.
How long does a low last for?
Usually about 10 to 15 minutes. Just like so many questions running through my head, like, why have you done that? Why?
What's Stop for point? A minute and tell me why. Tell me what those questions are.
It's just like, why have you done it? Just loads of stuff running through my head. Why did I need to do that? What's the point? And just none of it makes sense. It just makes me feel so shit.
But you couldn't control yourself. I mean, when we pulled up then, I mean, you'd more or less jogged over the car park. So what was going through your mind when you were between the car and the toilet? What went through your mind?
Just like that high and just that split second of enjoyment.
And it was the girl in the black hot pants?
Yeah.
Why her? We've been past about 1,000 girls in hot pants.
Not like hers. It's just the little things in what they wear and the way they walk that does it.
I really, really felt for Callum. Porn has clearly got a powerful grip on his life. And it's not just him. If the author of a recent book is to be believed, porn is having a far-reaching effect on an entire generation. Pornland is based on interviews with thousands of young people. The author, Gail Dines, has watched more porn than almost any academic on earth.
I follow the breadcrumbs of an 11 or 12-year-old boy, no credit card. When he puts porn into Google, what does he think he's going to come up with? Probably pictures of breasts, maybe a naked woman. In reality, when he puts porn into Google, he is catapulted into a world of sexual violence, sexual cruelty, body-punishing sex. He's not got a reservoir of his own experiences of sexuality with other people. He's probably never had sex with another human being. This is his first introduction to sex. He's got an erection, he's aroused. So I think he's assuming this is all about arousal. And I would go so far as to argue that pornography is actually sexually traumatizing an entire generation of boys. To be introduced into sex via, you know, gag me and then fuck me, via sites like Anally Ripped Whores, via sites like First Time with Daddy, I think that is a form of sexual traumatizing of our boys.
And what about men being violent towards women during sex because of what they see? Does violent porn create violence towards women?
When you interview young women and you hear about what's going on in sex, you're seeing an increased level of violence. Rough anal sex, rough vaginal sex, gagging. One student in particular was telling me how, in fact, her boyfriend said to her he'd like to do something different. He'd seen in porn. She didn't know what it was. He gagged her. She passed out, right? He gagged her to the point that she passed out. And what is interesting about that story is when she woke up, he wasn't trying to wake her up. He was washing himself off in the bathroom. She could have been dead for all he knew. So what young boys are really getting their sexual cues from are from men who are acting as if they're sexual psychopaths.
Some may dismiss this as moral panic, but I find it pretty compelling. Online porn does seem to be having a cultural effect. But how serious are the consequences? If you believe the headlines, young people are acting out the violent scenes they see online. But where's the evidence? London's Portman Clinic specialises in helping people of all ages with problems of sexual behaviour. Normally, it keeps out of the public eye, but not anymore, thanks to the dramatic rise in cases where children are using online porn. John Woods has treated dozens of teenage sex offenders.
10 years ago, there were very few cases where internet pornography was involved in a young person's offending behaviour. Now it's the majority.
There is no direct proof, is there, that watching violent porn in itself creates acts of violence towards women?
We have a great difficulty in proving the connection between this violent imagery and violent behaviour. But clinically, it's clear that there is a connection.
There's no evidence that watching violent porn as a child directly turns you into a sex offender. But in his clinic, The sex offending kids that John sees are more and more likely to be compulsive porn users.
One boy was definitely traumatized by what he would see. He was shocked and horrified by the body parts, by the acts of penetration, and the violence as well. The images would be in his mind that he would keep thinking about during the day, something of a torment that he has to get rid of. He used to then have to rush home, put on the computer, have the images so that they were out there on the screen, not in his head. So in a sense, re-traumatizing himself, reinforcing the imagery, so that ultimately, we picked up this story after he was found to have been sexually assaulting a child next door.
You know, I admit, I came here today, you know, pretty cynical about this porn causes crime business. We spent a day with John. He works with ordinary kids who end up raping children. They're so traumatised by what they see online, and even more worrying is that so many of them are watching porn now. The problem isn't going away. The question is, what the hell are we going to do about it? Making this programme has made it clear to me that porn is affecting teenagers' lives in a very real way. So what to do? Some say ban porn, but banning anything makes the liberal in me uneasy. Who guards the guardians? David Cameron wants internet service providers to switch on filters and turn them up to 11. Is a block even technically possible? I went to see a man who's just done an in-depth study of parental control software. But how does this software actually work?
Usually these things are a combination, so they'll look for the certain keywords. Sometimes they'll examine the images on a page, so if it sees a high degree of skin tones, it will say, well, that's likely to be a nude person, so we'll block that site. Often these companies work together to create these huge blacklists of sites that are off limits, if you like.
Barry showed me how one popular filter, OpenDNS, was a pretty blunt tool. At its highest setting, it even put Facebook on the blacklist.
Facebook, your kid's Facebook page, is out of bounds. It says, sorry, you can't access it on this network. Other sites, oddly, it's not so great on. So on this pornography site, for example, it lets it straight through. And that's because it's a blogging site, so it doesn't expect to find adult content on there.
But that's quite clearly two people having vigorous sex.
Yeah. Problem with all of these filters is there's always holes in them. And it would take an army the size of China to actively sit there looking at every site that's uploaded and trying to judge whether it's suitable or not. There simply isn't a perfect filter.
So are internet filters for children just pointless?
I don't think they're pointless. I think they have a place. I think if a parent wants to use them as part of a set of methods to help control internet access, then I think they have some value. I think what is extremely dangerous is for the government to say, once this is turned on, that'll be fine, the internet's protected, because it's not.
Clearly, parents have to get tech savvy. It's not good enough anymore to say, oh, I just don't understand computers. But we can't rely on filters. Sorry, Dave. So, could education be the answer?
My name's Johnny, which is an awful name for a sexual health worker, but it's true.
johnny Hunt is a sex and relationships education worker with a difference. He actually talks about sex and relationships and porn.
Just write the alphabet A to Z, and all I want you to do...
Johnny talks frankly to kids about everything they've seen, in porn and in real life, no matter how extreme.
First one that every single person in this whole room wrote was anal. In pornography, they just kind of stick it in, and that's not how your body works. What's this one?
But classes like this are the exception. Schools in Britain today are not obliged to teach anything more than the basic biology of sex and the dangers of having it. It's like the Pope wrote the curriculum.
OK, put your pens down.
But there's so much more to sex than that. And for an adolescent child, there are so many questions. When? Why? Who? Does it feel good? So where do they go for answers?
People want to know how you have sex, what you do, and where it goes and how to be good at it and what you should look like and
all that kind of stuff. A lot of young people I speak to go and look at pornography because they're not getting what they want from school sex education. And obviously, pornography is not necessarily the best place to have it, but at least it's opening conversations up. But if that's the only influence that young people are getting, then they're going to get a very skewed version of what sex is.
The thought that kids are going to hardcore porn for their sex education is horrifying. But there are now other places online that they can go. One council-funded website, which launched last year, offers a safe place for teenagers to ask any questions they have about sex. The website was set up by Amy Danahay and Etty Martin. And it was pilloried in the press for being too explicit.
We've put pictures of genitals on our website, yeah, which made the headlines. Local authorities putting pictures of genitalia on their website. Absolutely. That was a decision that we made because we wanted to give young people the information, but knowing that they were getting the correct information in a factual way and that we could help them to cope and to manage with what they were seeing out on the websites.
Amy and Etty believe that if kids were taught properly about sex from an early age, there wouldn't be such a desperate need for forums like this.
I think as a society, we need to be far more open, right from when, from children being very young.
Yeah.
We need to embrace the culture that the Dutch seem to have on the fact that we all have a body. You know, we all form relationships throughout our lives. We're all sexual beings from birth, and therefore we need to be talking about these things so that when it comes to the stage where children may be accessing porn, it comes up as everyday conversation.
This video promotes a sex education program in Holland called Spring Fever, which is taught to kids from age 4. Rather than turning them all into porn addicts or sex maniacs, levels of teenage pregnancies are 5 times lower than in the UK.
The sex from a mum door to getting hard.
Amy and Etty are bringing this model to the UK and introducing it into primary schools in Warwickshire. But you can't teach 4-year-olds about sex, can you?
We're not talking about teaching 4-year-olds sex. What we're talking about is feelings and emotions, and also some of the very factual parts of our bodies.
Yeah.
So you're saying that you teach a 4-year-old the word penis?
Yes. Yeah. It's very important that we all understand the correct terminology for genitals.
I've got to say, I do have a real sense of shock about that. I'm not a prude, but I still struggle with the fact that I would have to say to my boy, Daddy puts his penis in Mummy's vagina.
Mm.
Three
it's not
4-year-olds
easy.
Know about penises and vaginas. Because I call it, you know, Willy.
Mm. Yeah.
And that feels adventurous.
Maybe you should go on a course, Martin.
Maybe everybody should. Maybe
I
that's
think maybe
the point.
Maybe parents should.
It sounds pretty toe-curling to me, but Amy and Etty have a point. Sonny's just started primary school. If he could grow up with a comfortable understanding about the human body and healthy sex, then when he sees porn in a few years' time, which he will, he might be able to see it for what it is, fake.
Faster!
But what if you're sitting there watching this and your child is starting secondary school? Well, like it or not, you're the first generation of parents who has to have the porn chat. You need to let them know that what gets passed around the playground is not normal. It's not what real sex is all about. Awkward parental chats may be a bit late for young men like Callum, but all is far from lost. Fortunately, since the teenage brain is still developing, it has an extraordinary ability to change. Paula Hall is one of the country's leading sex therapists. We arranged for Callum to see her for an initial consultation.
So do you think you've got a high sex drive? Do you think it's because you're... Yeah.
It must be the reason. If I'm watching it 7 or 8 times a day and I get these urges constantly, then it must be.
You probably haven't.
if you get used to using your addiction for emotional regulation, so let's say every time you were angry, you masturbated, every time you were sad, every time you felt rejected, you start associating in your brain all of those emotions with masturbation. Yeah, they become triggers. So then it feels like it's a high sex drive, but the trigger isn't actually biological, it's emotional.
What about academically? Did you do well, GCSEs?
GCSEs done well, A-levels, no.
Failed? Like completely?
Yeah.
Screwed up, failed?
Yeah.
What were your results?
U's.
Oh, crikey. What did you get for GCSEs?
A's and B's.
Oh, blimey. Right, okay. Some of this is a defence mechanism against failure. And this thing about it's developed into a habit and you do it all the time has also happened in your brain. But it's become such an automatic response. So you need to understand what's happening there to beat it. And what tends to work best is actually doing a group treatment programme.
Callum is about to start on a 2-day course of therapy with Paula, and I wish him the very best of luck. But his situation and the journey of making this film have changed my mind about pornography, because porn has changed. My boy Sonny is growing up into a different world.
I just feel like my kid's childhood has been taken away by porn. And that's what it's done. It's just, it's forcing us into a situation we don't want to be in, but we're gonna have to be.
We live in the 21st century, the internet age, but sex education in schools, it's Victorian. It's ridiculous. I think I'm getting angry about it.
We've got to take the power back by being proactive. We've got to start talking.
Because nobody else will. By talking to our kids, we can keep them safe. It's going to be shit, but we've got to do it. And if we do it, they stand a chance.
Go to channel4.com/pornonthebrain to get tips on talking to young people about sex and porn, or help and support if you feel your porn use is getting out of control. And we're continuing our campaign for real sex next Monday. If you like sex and you like boxes, you might just like Sexbox. Lifting the lid at 10.